Coming up on the last part in our series, we're going to take a look at everything that you need to know for managing Office using System Center Configuration Manager. Now I'm going to walk you through all the steps to keep your managed Office apps up to date, when to install Office on top of an existing Office install, and how you can troubleshoot day-to-day issues. Now the move to click-to-run packaging across the board for Office client apps on Windows means that you'll want to be familiar with post-deployment servicing, how to lay out new capabilities, and also resolving issues. I'll start with post-deployment servicing. Remember back in planning, we explained the servicing channels, monthly, semi-annual, as well as semi-annual and monthly targeted channels. Now the monthly channel is going to include new features, bug fixes, and security fixes. Importantly, the semi-annual channel options still continue to receive regular security and bug fixes in between semi-annual releases. Again, monthly channel is recommended for general purpose PCs. Now in day-to-day operations, any of these updates may be targeted to your managed PCs. And if you don't have a history with click-to-run software updates, the way that updates are packaged and delivered is fundamentally different than before. Now these are full installation packages and the update process calculates the difference between what's on the PC and the update to choose the files that get applied. So there are no more MSP files. And updates can be applied to existing installs, whether they've been recently updated or are very out of date. Also, there's no need to reboot Windows as part of the Office update process. In general, software updates resemble in-place upgrades for already installed versions of Office. Now what it's going to do is it's going to look at a list of components that are offered in the package and see what's already there and still usable. Then it's going to determine the components that are out of date on a local machine and bring the out-of-date replacement plus all the net new components from the update package down. And like the initial install, you can point the Office update engine to files that are stored on-premises, on a local hard drive, or the internet, but internet connectivity is not always required. Now once the update engine compares what's already installed with what's needed in the update source, it's going to download those update files, and it's also going to save them temporarily into a place called Program Files, Microsoft Office Updates Download. Once the download's complete, the process then moves those files to Program Files, Microsoft Office Updates Apply, and at that point, closing and reopening the Office client apps are going to trigger a straight file swap to the new files, and then your Office is up to date. Now, if a user doesn't naturally close and reopen their Office apps or restart their PC as part of their normal workflow, Office by default is going to start to begin to notify the users via built-in Windows system tray notifications after 4 days has passed. After 6 days, a message will appear in the Office apps themselves informing the user that an update is ready to apply. Of course, there are group policies available to admins to modify notification behavior and update timing. Now, when ready, users simply need to save their work, close and reopen their Office apps. Then the update process itself just takes a couple of seconds, and again, it won't require Windows to reboot. Now let's look at the scheduled tasks that are run in Office. There are a few processes, such as office.c2rclient.exe, olicenseheartbeat.exe, and a few other Office processes run in regular schedules by default. Now these are doing things like looking for updates based on your channel and configuration, checking licensing status of the install and rearming as needed, and running background tasks to update Office. So the update detection by default now runs at login, weekly at 3 a.m., and also at computer idle times. Now if you're using SCCM, the update engine works in the same way, and we recommend that you continue to use automatic updates from the Office CDN for the majority of your PCs. Now what this will do is save you time discovering, downloading, and also pushing update packages to distribution points and collections. Now that said, you can still manually discover and approve updates to your click-to-run packaged Office apps using the normal update process in SCCM. By default, Office install packages created in SCCM are going to enable a property called Office Management Com to use your SCCM distribution points as a deployment and update source locations. Now these can be overridden post-installation using group policy to change the update location to use the Office public CDN as the update source. Now I mentioned that updates behave similar to an in-place upgrade, and since the update engine is pointing to a full set of installation source files, for certain post-deployment scenarios you can take the concept one step further and install Office on top of an existing install of the same version of Office, or what we call second install. Now a second install of Office can be used to make an addition to the existing Office install or to change what's there. You might use it for things like adding Visio or Project or any other previously excluded app. Or you can add a language pack. Now like the update process, the second install process in this case looks at what's already on the PC, compares it with the package and the properties you want to install, then basically applies what's different. So now we've described your servicing and post-deployment configuration options. Let's move on to troubleshooting and issues management. to troubleshoot updates or installs, office logs follow the following naming convention: machine name, year, month, day, and time. Now, logs themselves can help you troubleshoot deployment issues and are stored in app data, local temp, or windir temp. And you'll want to inspect the files also with Office, C2R, or click to run in their names. Now, you can use the Microsoft Office Support and Recovery Assistant tool to help troubleshoot common issues as well. You can also make sure Office scheduled tasks are present in Task Scheduler and haven't been disabled, and also check that the device can access your defined update path. For example, you can try pinging things like officecdn.microsoft.com and see if that resolves. You can also try pinging your SCCM distribution point or other custom defined location. Now, you're going to want to check program files, Microsoft Office updates download, and also the apply folders for the presence of update packages to make sure they're flowing in. Check the registry for the last trigger source to make sure it's set properly. Usually that's going to be set to scheduled task, and that's found in HKLM, Software, Microsoft, Office, Click to Run, Scenario, Update, or you can check HKLM, Software, Microsoft, Office, Click to Run Configuration for version to report and make sure that the version is correct. Now you can try deleting the Updates folder and Program Files, Microsoft Office, to see if triggering the update itself will actually hydrate those update files again. Now, in some cases, activation services will not rearm Office licensing. In these cases, the best things to do are check network connections and make sure they resolve to your licensing services. Ensure that the user is provisioned an Azure Active Directory and correctly entered their credentials. You're going to also want to ensure that the user is licensed for corresponding Office subscription versions. And if you're using KMS, make sure that that PC can hit the KMS service and that matching KMS keys have been installed on the KMS server. Now, you're also going to want to check if a product key is configured on the device. Now, this applies to all activation types, and to do that, you run ospp.vbs to check the licensing status. The command that you use is cscript, c program files, Microsoft Office, Office 16, ospp.vbs, using the dstatus switch. Now, in some cases, you'll need to use olicensecleanup.vbs to remove activation and then sign in again to reactivate. Now, certain Office issues might result in recently applied Windows updates or other apps installed on the device. Now, common questions and common cases that we hear about that are things like default file associations are lost. This is common, for example, when a PDF moves from Word to the Edge browser or Adobe Acrobat Reader, or pinned taskbar and start menu icons for Office apps getting unpinned after an update. Now, we've covered Windows 10 start and taskbar customization using PowerShell and policy as part of the Desktop Deployment Essentials series at aka.ms/DDEv4. Now, finally, to fix issues before uninstalling and reinstalling Office to a known working version, you can take steps on the local PC to attempt manual repairs. Now, this is where things like Quick Repair and Online Repair can help. Now, you'll access these options in Windows settings via Apps and Features, your Office install, and then the Modify button. Now, Quick Repair can run in standard user context without a local admin privilege, and without internet connectivity from locally stored source to perform simple tasks, things like taking back default file associations or DFAs. You can also do an online repair, which needs to be run with local admin privilege and internet connectivity, but essentially that's going to reinstall the affected version of Office according to previously configured installation parameters and properties. All right, so now you should be able to manage and keep your Office installs up to date in your desired configuration, and also troubleshoot common issues with a few common fixes. And if you want to see more in this series, go to aka.ms/officeitseries. Thanks for watching.